The rest of the commissioners are here with the exception of Mason Marin, who is ill this evening. I want to provide a little bit of an introduction, a little bit of a context for this meeting. People first came before the commission to propose allowing hunting, more hunting than is currently allowed, on conservation lands in Northampton about 3 years ago, but no formal proposals were put before us until this summer, and so we didn't seriously begin considering it until this summer. Some people in the public, both verbally and in writing in the paper, have expressed surprise, even a sense of outrage and betrayal that we would consider allowing such a thing. But in fact, once we receive a request, we're duty-bound indeed to consider it, and to consider it rationally rather than on the basis of our own personal preferences. The process by which we've been doing that consideration has had a few steps in it. First, we looked at our governing documents, the Massachusetts Wetland Act, the City Wetlands Ordinance, the City Open Space Plan, and we found that none of these documents prohibit funding, and in fact, the Open Space Plan actually says that as one of the priorities of the city, identifying additional spaces for hunting and other outdoor activities is one of the priorities, and that was developed in 2010 in a series of three public forums, large open meeting public forums, and nine hearings with various commissions. It was signed off by all the commissions. It was voted on and approved by the City Council December 16th, 2010. So we believe that our governing documents indicate that, in fact, nothing in those documents indicates that hunting is either prohibited on conservation land or that it is contrary to our charter or purpose as a commission. The next thing we did was to look at practice among other conservation commissions and municipalities throughout the Commonwealth. And it turns out that we have learned that municipalities throughout the Commonwealth do allow hunting on their conservation lands, with quite a variety of the way in which they allow that. Some allow hunting only as long as it's consistent with state law but have no other constraints. Some allow only bow hunting. Some allow only hunting with certain species and only in certain seasons. Learning all of this, we then called, various of us on the commission, called people in each of those communities who are on the Conservation Commission or who are paid staff within those communities responsible for this, and asked them what their experience has been, what they learned from this, what problems they've encountered, or if any, or what had they learned that might be useful for us in Northampton. In addition, we then held two additional hearings in our normal process in the hearing room, a much smaller venue than this, and listened to people, pro and con, for several hours. In those cases, we were trying to demonstrate that we wanted to learn as much as we can before we reach any conclusion. In short, we have so far approached this topic in a way that we think is our responsibility to approach it. It's the same way, most of what we do is actually a whole lot more boring than this. We are responsible for the implementation of the Massachusetts Wetlands Act and the City Wetlands Ordinance, and most of what that means is that people come before us when they want to do any kind of construction or disruption of any kind in or near a wetland or a riverfront or anything like that. And we have to decide whether we're able to permit that, and if so, under what conditions. And so most of our act is permitting implementation of the Wetlands Act and the City Ordinance. We do also have responsibility for acquisition and management of open space, which is how this all comes up. But we think that we've been approaching this so far, and that this is a continuation of that process. We have a couple of proposals that were brought before us to allow hunting, and we decided rather than specifically just rule on one of those, let's begin the larger discussion about hunting in conservation lands in Northampton. And we believe that it's the the approach that we've taken and have felt obligated to take is the one that we would hope even the most passionate of the public, maybe especially the most passionate of the public, would want to take if they were in our roles. At our last meeting, Councilor LaBarge, who is here tonight, and others urged that we convene a larger hearing in a venue that City Hall wouldn't allow, and that's how we got to this meeting tonight. We hope this will be something more like a teach-in than a tug-of-war that we want to hear as commissioners and learn so that we can make, when the time comes, an informed decision. A few ground rules. First, what this discussion is or is not about. The topic is whether to allow some hunting on some city-owned conservation parcels at some times and under some conditions. It is not an on-off switch. It's not a discussion about whether we allow all hunting all the time, no matter what, without constraint. Nor is it, or on it, or the only alternative is to prohibit all hunting in all cases. That's not what this is about. If there's good reason to prohibit all hunting, then that's what we can do. If there's good reason to prohibit hunting in some, but not all, and allow certain hunting in certain conditions, we can do that too. We can adopt whatever policy we believe makes sense here in Northampton. Second, the discussion is not a debate, as the Gazette unfortunately characterized it at one point, between hunters on one side and conservationists on the other side. The hunters who have presented before us so far consider themselves to be conservationists, and in fact, throughout the history of the United States, hunters have been some of the most active of conservationists. Third, this is not about gun control. We've had people come in their prior hearings advocating that guns be disallowed. The Conservation Commission, that's not under our purview. There's a lot of things that are not under our purview. That's one of them. We can't do anything about gun laws. Fourth, the commission will not make a decision today. We won't even make one tomorrow. We have a full schedule on our normal every other Thursday conservation meeting tomorrow with permitting requests. And so we won't be making a decision about this tomorrow either. We don't have a specific deadline by which we have to make a decision. We have been engaging in an open learning process and a discussion, and we'll see where this process goes from here. How this hearing will be conducted, we will call people in the order in which they signed up. We ask that you speak for less than 3 minutes. We ask that you speak to the commissioners, not among yourselves, not to a previous speaker. This is a way to keep the process in, as a learning exercise rather than an argument. And finally, we ask that everyone speak with a sense of civility and respect. I like to think, I will assert that Northampton is a better place than a lot of places around the country where people assume that because somebody else disagrees with them, that they're malevolent, irresponsible, or evil. I think we're above that here, and I hope that we can conduct ourselves in a way that demonstrates that here tonight. That all of us expect that if we have something to say, we want to be listened to. And I think we expect of ourselves also that we want to listen. So we'll begin with approximately 20-minute presentation. The commission wanted to learn, because we're not experts in the area of hunting, we wanted to learn from the people who are. And we thought as long as we're going to have them talk to us, we would have them talk to us in this setting so that it could be public available information as well. And so we have Ralph Taylor, who's a district supervisor for the Mass Division of Fisheries and Wildlife, the Connecticut Valley District, and David Steinbrook, who's a deer and moose project leader, who are going to walk through a presentation for us. Gentlemen. Again, apologize for not having a microphone. We'll have to just try and listen as carefully as we can.
Now, I just wanted to take the time to introduce myself. I'm the District Wildlife, Fish and Wildlife Supervisor for this area, and I manage wildlife in Franklin, Hampshire, and Hamden County. I've been in the area doing this job for almost 30 years now, so I know the area pretty well. We actually have quite a few bears in Northampton, as you all know. So we do a lot of GPS calling of bears in the city. One of these days, we'll come back and do another presentation for you about GPS calling.
I can't hear you.
Can I not talk this way? Shall I speak loud?
Everyone, you guys, we can't hear you though.
If they want to podium, then you'll be able to.
Good idea.
Thank you.
So, all I wanted to do was make sure that people were aware where my office is. I have my information is in the back from the abstracts for hunting and fishing. So you can see when the seasons are for hunting and fishing and all of the other things that go along with it. I also have my business card back there. And there are probably 30 copies of various versions of our Mass Wildlife magazine. So please take those and to get an idea of what the agency is about and who we are. And that was all I was going to say, unless there's questions. But Dave Daybrook is our state servant project leader, meaning both deer and moose. And he's going to speak to you now and give you a little bit of the biological end of what we use hunting for.
So I'm really going to just be talking about white-tailed deer, how we manage white-tailed deer in the state. And then, you know, I can kind of address some of the issues that I work a lot with towns that go through this, mostly in the eastern part of the state, but you guys are the only ones going through this. There's other towns going through the same motions. So hopefully we can learn from what they've dealt with and move through the motions a little bit faster on making an informed decision on what. So I'm going to be talking about how we manage deer, what are some of the caveats that we run into in some suburban situations, and hopefully you guys at the end of this will have the information we need to move on to make any decisions. As far as the laws and regulations, I'm not really going to get into that too much because we just have so much. I highly recommend you pick up one of our hunting abstracts in the back. It goes through all of our hunting and fishing regulations and laws. Alright, so first I'll kind of go through what are the habitats that deer live in, what are they eating, what do they require? So pretty much in the spring and summer, they're eating forbs and leaves. They're not in your yards eating the grass. They're actually picking up a weed, the things you don't want in your yard anyways. They'll eat some tender grass, but for the most part they're picking out things like clover, pretty much these types of weeds browse on some of the bushes and everything. They're not cows, they're not grazing. In the fall and winter, they move on to hard mast, which are acorn, beechnuts. Those are the real high protein, high carbohydrate foods they need to pack on fat to overwinter. And then once those food resources diminish in the late winter and into spring, they're really relying on woody vegetation to carry them through the winter. So these are things like red maple, white oak, anything that's at their level that they can browse on. As far as home range, we typically see about 2 square miles for a home range, so from any one point about a mile out. For females, it shrinks a little bit. For males, it can even be a little bit larger, especially right now, which is their mating season. Males can push that to over 2 square miles, really moving around. So when you're talking about at a town level, it's not always just your town. You have surrounding towns, and that's where I come in. I try to help towns realize that it's a regional management, and we're all working this together. And one of the things that I think is a disconnect with a lot of people is that suburban areas are actually wonderful for deer. I guess the thought is that as you clear forests for development, you're losing forests for deer, but actually it provides great resource for deer. You have your ornamental landscaping, which is great for their winter time and their food out there. There's plenty of cover, and I'll get into what else it provides, which is basically limited state districts. In fact, it prohibits hunting around 500 feet from those houses, so unless you have permission. So it creates the sanctuary where they don't have to deal with the pressure of hunting. They can continue to grow that, and then there's plenty of food. Why are deer important? So they're important for our state, for me as a wildlife manager. They're important, they're valuable species on the landscape. They need to be there. What we want to do is we want to make sure they're at levels, though, that they're not considered pests. We want to make sure they're at that sustainable level. They're not causing damage to the forest. We don't have high risk of public safety. and you know, we want to make sure they're at the level where they're not impacting the habitat and other species as well. So what happens when they become overpopulated? And, you know, overpopulated, there's a very general term. It can really be anything greater than whatever you want it to be. But in my sense, I'm going to say, once it's the point where we're seeing an impact, negative impact on the habitat, and we tend to see that around greater than 20 deer per square mile of forest. And this is important because the forest is really where they're bedding and their overwinter food is at. So we always look at density per square mile of forest. So what happens when those deer numbers climb above that? You know, it gets to the point where people start viewing them as pests. That's not something our agency wants to see. It's not something I want to see. They're important. What else? What do you see on the landscape? Well, we see that they start impacting plant diversity. We're not seeing the same type of diversity of flowers and other types of vegetation. Sometimes this can give a competitive advantage to invasive plants that we don't really want out there. Some of these plants that the deer don't really touch. And we also see some decrease in forest regeneration. So, you know, in areas where you have a lot of deer browsing, you tend to see that you're not regenerating your oaks, you're not regenerating your maples, you're having, say, more black cherry, more white pine, these types of trees that they don't typically browse. So over time, your forest structure changes. It's not the type of forest structure that we want to see that diversity for all wildlife species. Not to mention, if you are managing your forest for timber, certainly you're going to have some problems with deer browsing and trying to generate trees in the future. Really, this needs to underscore it. If it gets so bad to the point where, you know, in some areas where you have really high deer numbers and a lot of browsing, it can actually create a situation where once those trees that are your mature trees over 50 years old, once those die, fall over, there's nothing to replace it but some of the things they don't eat. And that's not really what we want to see. As far as what are some of their mortality factors, what are causing them to avoid something in the state? Disease really isn't a big factor here in Massachusetts. We do have a little bit of issues with them dying, typically not from disease. So that's good. And that's mostly because we do have, for the most part, lower deer densities compared to some of the other states. And as you know, once deer numbers climb, the incidence of disease increases. Predators are an important mortality factor here. From studies around New England and northeastern states, we tend to see that predators, as far as black bears, coyotes, and bobcats, combine take anywhere from 20 to 35% of fawns every year. And then, as far as other things like vehicle collisions, once you factor that in, altogether, you have anywhere between 35 and 50% of fawns every year will die from that. And kind of in areas where you don't have a lot of traffic, you tend to see more of it from predators. In areas in eastern Mass where you also have high predator numbers, but you start to see that more of them are hit by cars, and then they're therefore scavenged on by these predators rather than killed. But for the most part, you're seeing that, you know, around 30 to 50% of the fawns will not survive every year. And you would think that's a high number. And that would be problematic, but because adult female survival is so high, they'll just have more fawns the next year and the next year and next year. And you continue to see that grow. So the only way that we can really manage deer numbers throughout the state is through regulated hunting. And this is where we can actually slow growth, stabilize it, or decrease it. And so this is kind of a hypothetical model as far as what you typically see for growth. The purple dotted line is if there was nothing at all affecting deer, there was no mortality, just an absolute exponential increase. But this isn't realistic. This doesn't happen because there are always going to be mortality factors. So when you look at some of the studies that have pinpointed those mortality factors, you tend to see something like that blue curve. So over time, you know, a period of 8 to 10 years, even with vehicle collisions, predators combined, you still see deer growth. In this is what we're seeing in some of these areas where we don't have, we have limited access for hunting. We're seeing these numbers climb up about the same rate this model suggests in the blue line. The red dotted lines are kind of two different scenarios of different levels of hunting and harvest rates. The top one being something like a low harvest rate, maybe from an archery hunting program that is not very large, where you're not really able to reduce density, but you are doing something good, which is 10 years down the road, you're keeping deer numbers maybe where you are now or maybe a little bit higher, rather than doubling or tripling what you have right now. And then in the lower red one is one where, say that the number you have right now is not what you want, and you want to bring down those numbers. This is a higher harvest rate where we're able to do that. And this is kind of what we're doing in some of the zones across the state where we see numbers a little bit higher than where we want them to be. And
how do you decide where you want to be?
I'll go through that. So how do we affect the harvest rate and how that affects the population? It's really the female harvest. You take one male out of the population, it's really not going to make an effect. You take one female, that's effectively 3 deer the next year, multiplied by every single year exponentially. So this is where we really target that. And I'll get into that basically through our annual permit allocation that we do across the state. And that's where we dictate the female harvest based on that. So what are our state management, deer management goals? First, we want to make sure that across the state, we have deer densities that are below a level where, certainly below ecological carrying capacity, but even lower than that. We want it to be lower than where we start to see major impacts on the forest and other habitat and species that we are also responsible for managing, like the wood thrush, other types of birds. The culture and carrying capacity is where things get pretty muddy. Some people don't want any deer around their land. Some people want twice as many as they have. It's a large scale, and we kind of want to make sure that we're somewhere in the middle, that we have enough deer for hunting and viewing opportunities, but not so many that we have issues with public safety and public health. And certainly, this is going to change across the state. We also want to make sure we're not seeing a lot of ag and property damage. And then, finally, we want to make sure that the deer population in the state of Massachusetts is healthy. We don't want to see them starving. We don't want to see them showing an indicator of stress. We want to make sure they are healthy. So how do we manage the numbers here across the state? We have regulated hunting seasons for all the wildlife species that are hunted. Deer, we have 3 seasons. First and foremost, to be able to hunt, you need to buy a hunting license. And then if you want to hunt during one of these seasons, archery or muzzleloader, you need to buy an archery or muzzleloader stand to be able to hunt those seasons. In order to get a hunting license, you actually have to take a hunter safety course, or have taken one beforehand. So I'm originally from Pennsylvania. I took my hunter safety course in Pennsylvania, had a license. I came here, I got a license. So you just have to have taken it at some point. And in that hunter safety course, they go through a lot of information that I still remember to this day, exactly whether you should take the shot or not, or how do you be responsible out there. So the archery season opened. It runs till November 30th, and the shotgun season is 2 weeks from December 2nd to December 14th. During the shotgun season, you can use archery methods. You can use muzzleloaders. During the muzzleloader or primitive season, that runs from December 16th to the end of the year. And during the muzzleloader season, you can use archery methods, but not a shotgun. And that's statewide. And then, so with your hunting license, you get 2 antlered deer tags. And then you can purchase additional antlerless deer tags, depending on their availability. So we allocate antlerless deer permits. And this is basically to regulate the female harvest across the state. We also track harvest. It's mandatory to report your harvest. This year is the first year that we're offering online harvest reporting for the archery muzzleloader season. Only the shotgun is going to stay the same. They have to bring it to the shotgun. that's mostly so we can collect biological data, which is important for our management. So across the state, we have numeric deer density goals. And as you can see, on the western part of the state, they're higher than on the eastern part of the state. And this is really because of that cultural carrying capacity where as you move into the more developed areas, they don't exactly want as many to balance those issues. And in the western part of the state, where the culture accepts a little bit higher deer numbers and some of the issues, we can have higher numbers. But the goals are all well below where you start to see impacts on that. So these are what our goals are. The next slide will be, where are we with respect to these goals? And we break up the state into 15 wildlife management zones. You can see 14 is a common number, but 4 was broken into 4 more people zones. And these are based on ecological boundaries, because deer certainly disregard our political boundaries in a lot of ways. But if you have rivers and geographical features and major interstates that really change their behavior as far as how they move, that's where we have these in here. So as far as the goal about the healthy, balanced deer population, where are we in the state? We have very good physical condition of deer. The age structure is great, well balanced. And one of the indicators we also look at is yearling male antler peak diameter. And this is an indicator of the health of the population. Because basically, their first 2 years of their life, especially for males, they're putting all the resources into body growth. And if they have anything extra, they're going to start putting in antler development. So typically, if you see, you know, antler beam diameters for yearling males above the 15 millimeters, this is what the literature suggests, then you're not having stress in the population. We have our average are across the state. So we're well above that level. We have very healthy deer. And then the next thing with balancing ecological and social care, that's really what these numeric goals are, to reach that balance. So where are we? For the most part, you can see for western through central Massachusetts is either at goal, slightly above, or slightly below. So we can get our deer densities in these areas to goal with hunting. There's plenty of access, for the most part, in this part of the state to reach those goals. The problem lies in zones 10, 11 in the islands where access is restricted, or there's hunter effort issues, where we really don't have enough access to bring those deer numbers down, for the most part. You know, certainly within a whole zone, it's not all uniform. You can have some areas where you have low deer numbers, and some areas where you have really, really high deer numbers. So for instance, in zone 10, our deer density estimate there is greater than 25 deer per square mile, of course. Certainly you can have, say, one of our wildlife management zones, or wildlife management areas, one of the state-owned properties that we own and manage, in zone 10 that has 15 deer per square mile, of course, because there's adequate hunting. You can have another area that's within discharge setbacks, has plenty of deer habitat, very limited hunting, that has over 50 deer per square mile. So again, it's not uniform. But how we calculate these numbers is based on harvest data. And so in a lot of these areas, you know, there's limited access to hunting. We're really not getting as much data as we would like to be able to tell you, in your specific town, you have X number of deer. But we can certainly look at other indicators on the ground as far as the forest health to tell you where you're at. The islands are a whole different ballgame. I don't want to put that. The next thing is, where are we with respect to the goal, and which way is the population going? What we see for the most part is growing or stable populations in the central in western part of the state. And a lot of this is intentional. We have been keeping permits, endless permits, on the lower end. We try to get those numbers up, especially in 2 and 4S, and also 1 through 5. We try to get those up to where we'd like them to be for the goal. And again, in the eastern parts, we're seeing the population still continue to grow, and it's really limited. Our ability to manage this is really limited by access for hunters to be able to do something. So what do they need? What do hunters need to be able to manage the deer population? What do we need for them to have to do that for us? They need to have access. And this is land that's open to hunting. It also, which is often neglected, is a place for them to park. They need it somewhere that they can park. A lot of times, it's not legal for them to park on the side of the road in some areas, so each town's different. And then the next thing is they need to be able to have effective methods to be able to harvest enough deer. Statewide, you know, we have those regulated seasons. If you're hunting on one of our wildlife management areas, you can use, you know, any of these, whether it's a firearm or archery methods. But, you know, some towns do have bylaws that prohibit firearms, and then they really, you know, they do affect, that impacts their effectiveness of being able to manage deer in their town. So in for state laws, there are what are called discharge setbacks. And this is a statute, it's not one of our agency regulations. Basically, this says two things. One, no discharge of a fire or release of an arrow within 150 feet of a paved road. And no possession of a loaded firearm or hunting within 500 feet of an occupied dwelling, unless authorized by the owner or occupant. So that means that, essentially, if you're within 500 feet of houses, you cannot hunt there unless you get the permission. And if you own a, or if you're in a house and a hunter knocks on your door and says, can I hunt with the fire in your house, you have the ability to say, yes, you can. You also have the ability to say, no, I'm not comfortable with that, but, you know, if you want to hunt within 200 feet of my house, I don't want you any closer to it. You can do that as well. You have that ability to give them that permission. But again, if it's a, say, a housing development with 25 houses, you need to get permission from all 25 houses. The odds of that are pretty low. And that's where what leads into some of these issues in a lot of these areas where you have these large blocks of land that are just essentially closed to hunting. And then additionally, a lot of towns will have ordinances and bylaws that further restrict hunters and access and what they can use. And this, you know, it essentially adds another layer of you need to get written permission from the owner. You need to get permission from all the houses. You need to allow them to use the car. All these things add up. It really makes it difficult. And this is what the state discharge setback looks like on the ground. So here we have a road and one house, a lot of forest around it. The 500 feet from that dwelling and 150 feet from the road, essentially, this makes 18 acres of setback that cannot be hunted without permission. And that's just one house. When you add in a lot of other houses, you really see how much forest and land is, you know, is essentially within this district setback. The idea of this is to protect homeowners and people over there to make sure that they're marked within 5 or 3 of their houses, you know, if they're So I mentioned some of the towns that have these bylaws. There's actually from a survey that was done in 2003, I believe. There were 41 towns, mostly in Eastern Mass, that prohibit the discharge of firearms. And I can tell you right now, when I deal with some of these towns, they're the ones that are really dealing with high deer numbers. You know? And there's not much they can do without some small, localized archery facilities. 85 towns out of the 351 towns have a bylaw that requires landowner permission. And this is, it doesn't seem like it's that big of a deal, but it can be, especially when you have absentee landowners and you know, issues where you're walking the woods, you don't know when you move from one owner to the next owner when you're out there. It just makes it very difficult to have that permission to be able to find out who owns everything. And then there's also 35 that have special restrictions. In the 2003 survey, it did mention that Northampton had a special restriction, but after talking to Sarah, she did not see any type of special restriction. So I guess it's just like a little bit. And our GIS mapping guy in my office put together a map for Northampton, and you know, it gives you some stats on, you know, how many acres you have, how many are forested, you know, what's forested in the setback, all that type of stuff. And then so basically what the red lines are showing what is currently in the state discharge setback. So if you live in one of these areas where you're surrounded by all that red, you know, essentially you're in one of those discharge setbacks where there shouldn't be hunting unless somebody allow them to go, you know, the 500 feet of their house. But we also noticed there's a lot of areas that are outside of that discharge setback, which are essentially, you know, far from houses, far from the property. And I guess a lot of those do coincide with some of the townland properties. So Ralph put together some of the shape files of the townland properties, and I'll kind of go through that here. These highlighted in blue are some of the townland properties. And once we put the discharge setback over that, you can see that a lot of them, you know, for the most part, are outside the discharge setbacks. And the ones, the town owned properties that are in the discharge setbacks, obviously they would not be able to. And I guess the next point is, when you guys move forward into figuring out what, you know, what kind of things you want to do, you know, it moves from being more effective and being able to manage deer to less effective. And, you know, as far as where you guys are with your deer densities here, they're obviously not as bad as what it is in some of the eastern towns where they're already high deer numbers and they're trying to bring them down. What you guys have is probably somewhere between, you know, right around 15 deer per square mile of forest, but in some of these areas where you have a lot of limitations on hunter access, that number could be climbing, and you don't really know what it is unless you go out there and try to do some sort of intensive survey. So the good news is you're at the point now where you want to make sure that you're not in a problem 10 years from now, but you're not already at the problem. So as far as the decision process here, you know, if you allow hunting just like we allow on all of our state-owned properties, that's going to be certainly the most effective. As you start restricting what seasons or what you can use if it's archery only, what you need permission, those types of things are all going to affect your ability to manage deer. But in a lot of cases, some of these towns, that's what they choose, and that for their situation, it works. And it's better than not having any hunting at all, because it's still will help to manage deer and to prevent that growth. Some of the examples of towns that have done this: Dover, Medfield, Weston, a bunch of other ones. And actually, North Grafton, I spoke with, I gave a presentation there 2 weeks ago, and I really liked their, it's the North Grafton Land Trust, it's not the Conservation Commission, but they put together a wonderful program, volunteer-based, and they're able to balance all types of recreational activities on the property. They have hunting at the same time, they have dog walkers at the same time, they have cross-country skiers all at the same time, with no problems. Really amazing. And I would highly recommend that you try to reach out to them, because you know, they dealt with the same stuff you're dealing with now. And maybe they're a little bit further ahead, might provide some good opportunity. And I think that's more similar to what you guys are going through than some of the issues with, say, Weston, where it's, you know, it's a whole different area there. And I guess that concludes it. So.
Let me ask first, if I can, if the commissioners have any questions that they'd like to ask David. Guy?
In the wildlife management zones where you have so low the targeted population density, is that due to hunter effort and harvest, or is that other factors in that?
Can you repeat his question so we can hear it back here?
The zones that were below goal, and I mentioned we were trying to bring those numbers up. His main question is, why were they below goal? And the answer to that was that historically in those areas, we had analyst permits at a level that we weren't seeing growth. And so we've been making minor changes over time, and you kind of have to make those changes gradually. And we're at the point now where we're dropping numbers, analyst permit numbers, to get those numbers up, and we're seeing that growth. It's just not as rapid of a growth as we'd like to see. We don't want to see it super, you know, super fast, but you know, it's just kind of stabilizing, slowly growing. And one of the reasons why I say growth, the growth of the population there isn't as great as in other parts of the state, that's mostly because of the habitat. So, you know, as far as, say, zone 2 around the Berkshires, the quality of habitat there just isn't the same as some of the, you know, some of the Connecticut Valley where you have lot of agriculture, nutrient-rich soils, everything that the deer needs.
Could I ask, check a couple of things. I infer from what you said that there's no rifle deer hunting allowed in that.
There's no rifle allowed for deer hunting.
Is it also true that there's no hunting allowed on Sundays?
There is no hunting allowed on Sundays.
Is there any association that is known between deer populations and Lyme disease?
It's not a linear trend. It's more of a threshold. And essentially, once you're able to bring deer numbers down below, say, 15 deer per square mile forest, you're starting to get to the point where you're limiting tick abundance, because there could be some adult female ticks that never get their blood meal and therefore never lay their eggs. But say your deer numbers are at 30 deer per square mile, and you bring them down to 20, probably not going to stop that, but if you're able to bring them down lower where you're able to, the big thing is you want to make sure that some of those female ticks aren't getting their blood.
Thank you. Anybody else on the commission?
Yeah, I have a question about the deer grouse. I'm very familiar with that in terms of the profession, I agree. But I'm wondering, in terms of Northampton, say you're below threshold or the numbers that you want in the zone. So are you seeing any problems with deer grouse despite that at this point, or is the forest relatively healthy?
I haven't walked around Northampton, but I can certainly imagine there are spots in every zone in the state where you have issues with deer grouse impacts, localized effects. You can certainly have, in this area where they have limited access to hunting or whatever reason, you have high deer density. It's not like they're moving 5 miles away to find food. It's relatively localized. You could have very high deer numbers and over-browsing here. 2 miles down the road, you could have very low deer numbers. It's really localized, so the numbers that we provide in the goals are really the larger level. We really don't have the resources to look down to a very fine scale. I'd love to be able to. I'd love to be able to tell you, I walked through your course, and here's what the browsing is all about.
Anybody else? Public, there's a question over here.
I just have a question. I understand that the huge assumption that it's here, but hunting is allowed only around other times.
Correct. Yeah, there's a few times where there's nothing in season, but as far as looking in the abstract, it has all the hunting season.
No, I've seen that before. So when we talk about hunting, we're really talking about a year-round hunting situation, not just deer hunting, which is what you're addressing.
What I said in the introduction, I don't know if you were here, is that the communities can allow as little or as much. It isn't an on-off switch. It can be only certain seasons, only certain weeks, only certain weapons, only certain species, etc.
I appreciate that, but what I'm saying right now is, as in standard hunting, is a year-round situation. So we talk about hunting on any place. We're really talking about, in Northampton, as far as I'm aware, you can hunt all year round.
So one thing I could bring up is, I sent out a hunter survey to try to see just how many hunters, what percentage of our hunters are hunting different types of species, different seasons. And from our licensed buyers, 86% of our licensed buyers target deer. Other species, I think the next one was spring turkey, which was like 35%, and then down to squirrels was like 15%. So as far as, are you going to encounter a deer hunter that's on the property? Probably a lot higher of a chance of, because 86% of our hunters hunt deer, versus in the summer, encountering somebody that's targeting some other species. If only 50% of the hunters are going after, fall turkey, you're probably not going to run into them. It's not that prevalent of a species that people are out after.
Other questions? Sir?
Just a point of factual clarification. Northampton has over 22,000 acres of landmass. And is it 12,000 plus acres that are available to hunters, 47%? Or I also saw a figure of 60%.
I'll go back to that, 'cause I didn't actually read those off. So it says over 22,000 acres in the city, the town. Just over 13,000 acres are within the setback. 12,000. Of that 13,000, 12,700 are forested. So there's 12,700 acres of forest that are closed hunting, essentially, unless you have permission. Or sorry,
Yeah, and then, so basically that is 60% of your town is within the discharge of that.
Four.
So 40% of the town is.
Okay, so 40%.
And the Conservation Commission owns 2,460 acres, so those 2,400 acres is the one we're talking about today.
Well, and also that any other conservation lands are within the setback area, so they're not even eligible for consideration of hunting.
So, just a quick question, can you make that chart and the other one available somehow on the internet so that that's a reference?
Yeah, I think we could provide
this. If you can get it to Sarah, we can have it posted on the website.
Great, thank you.
We can definitely do that.
I was very interested to hear that we do not have a deer population problem in this area. And I'd like to ask you whether we have overpopulation problems with other animals, particularly those.
Yeah, so I didn't necessarily say that you don't have an overpopulation problem with deer. You can certainly have localized areas with overpopulation. But in general, of the hunted areas in this larger management zone that your town is in, we don't have overpopulation.
Right.
But certainly, in your town, same with all your neighboring towns, you certainly can have overpopulation issues at a localized level. And deer, again, deer are not the only thing you have. Other wildlife species, for instance, black bear, you definitely have high numbers of black bear in North. You know that.
Overpopulation, though?
Compared to what we would like to see for goals, numbers of black bears, I mean, you have to really do some sort of intensive surveys in Northampton to tell you how many.
We live here.
We have the resources to do it, but we do know that based on trends, you have to speak to our bear biologists, but based on what we see in other areas of the state, certainly Northampton tends to be a little bit higher than other parts of the state. Even tend to see overlapping home ranges of being one, which is not.
So there's a question over here. Sir?
Just to be crystal clear, are you saying we're in the zone where we're below the density that's desirable for deer population? And if that's true, then you're not encouraging more hunting in this area to control the density?
No, so again, we're dealing with, I manage at a much larger level than your town. I can't come to your town and tell you how many deer you have right here. So when I'm looking at hunter harvest information, in the zones that your town is in, you're kind of in a couple different zones. You're not in one, the middle of one zone, so you're kind of in the middle.
So which zone are we in?
It's between 4S, 7, and...
We're actually 4 North, 4 South. With Route 66.
For the most part, those zones are right at goal.
They're what?
They're right at our goal.
So you're not
right around the
more hunting.
I didn't say that.
You said you control the number of permits.
Exactly. Those go to areas that are open hunting. So if you have an area that's close to hunting, there's no deer being harvested there, you can have open propagation in that area. I would certainly recommend trying to promote opening areas for access to hunting to get those deer numbers in line with where we are in the water resource. So when I'm telling you what the deer density is in the zone, that's based on the available land.
Okay, this is a point of clarification, a question for clarification. We're talking about wildlife, not about stalking, for example, pheasant. I read the abstract, and there's like a pheasant hunting, and that's stalked. It's not a wildlife native bird. So
yeah,
we're not talking about stalking for hunting purposes.
That wouldn't be something
Okay, thank you.
Just to state a point too, that and I believe if you go back to the map, 4 North and South actually run from the Connecticut border to the Vermont line. When he talks about sections, we basically split that in half.
So
you're talking about a large region.
Yeah, so you are split between 4 North and 4 South. And again, even these zones are small in comparison to some of our neighboring states. You can't really go any smaller. We need an update. It is a very large.
Let's take this one or two. We want to make sure there's time left for us to we have 40 people signed up to speak, so we want to make sure there's time enough for that. Let's get one back here in the middle, please.
I'm sorry,
I just wanted to ask, since the amount of land that's under consideration by the Conservation Commission is so very small, in your view, if we had an excess deer population, would opening that tiny area for hunting be a significant way of controlling that deer population?
Yeah, so her question is, say you can only open a small amount of land, is that going to impact anything? Is it really going to make a big deal? And this is a question that I get a lot from towns, because they're dealing with, say, a 40-acre parcel, whereas your areas are much larger. And they say, if we open this 40-acre parcel, is this really going to do anything? And the answer is, if it's adjoining areas that are all open to hunting, probably not as big of an impact if it was all closed to hunting and you open this area. That's really going to, you're providing access. And the next thing is, when you open 40 acres, it's not that you're only able to remove, you know, a few deer that live there. You're essentially, with that 40 acres, you have overlapping home ranges of deer all over the place. You know, so that you're able to cause an impact maybe even out to a mile or so from that little spot. So it would be something, and we certainly see that in areas where they have small areas open to hunting. We see, you know, some of the neighboring areas are, you know, the people are saying, hey, we're not seeing as much damage on our landscape. We're not seeing.
You said the deer have a range of about 2 miles. So I just wondered, can the Conservation Commission people tell me, are the areas that are under consideration to open for hunting, are they contiguous with places where hunting is currently happening?
We wouldn't have any way to know that. Because that's all private land.
It's really hard to know, you know, is this place open to hunting or is this place open to hunting? We can certainly tell you if it's state owned, you know, whether DCR, our property, whether it's open or not, but private lands, I mean, yeah.
Let's take one more question, and then we'll move on to protect the time for people to speak.
I just have a very quick question. You said how many acres was available for potential hunting?
Well, first of all, Sarah, the number for total conservation lands is what?
2,460 acres.
Okay. And there's only a few of those areas. Can you go back to the map that shows our conservation? It would be really helpful to have an overlap of those two things. Oh, okay, we do, because this is where it's...
Yeah, so the blue is in front of the pink, so
still here.
I think the ones that Ralph put labeled on are certainly the ones that are outside.
Right, and so those are the areas that are under consideration. Every other area, if there's within a setback, we're not even considering it. That's something to keep in mind. And bear in mind, too, that we're not considering anything at this point. We're here to listen to you today. We'll make some informed decisions based on your inputs and other research that we're doing.
Okay, we've got one more minute here before we click to 8 o'clock, so take this one in front, please.
Do you seem to be saying that a fully geared wood hunting is the only way you have to manage the deer population? But are there other ways to manage the deer population than this? Natural predators?
So we know that with natural predators, you mean like wolves? Mountain lions and wolves are their natural apex predators. Without them,
coyotes? You don't think coyotes kill deer?
Coyotes do kill deer, but they are not their natural predators here. Coyotes move in.
Partially fill
the niche of those apex predators like wolves and mountain lions. In areas where you do have those, yeah, they can certainly control the population. But here, with coyotes, with black bears, with vehicle collisions, all those combined are not able to stabilize or decrease deer numbers. We know that. Studies have shown that. The only way, and the only legal way, to remove deer in the same situations is through regulations. Other methods are not legal.
So David, thank you. The way I'm going to do this, we have 40 people signed up to speak, and the way I'm going to do this is I'm going to, at the first, call two names. The first one I'm going to ask to come up to the podium, and the next one to stand ready, so that we're not wasting too much time between speakers. And then each time I'll call the name of the next person until we're done. Once again, I ask that everybody keep their talk to less than 3 minutes. Sarah is going to have a timer, so so that we can let you know when there's 30 seconds left. Is that able to... We have enough time for three. With 40 people, we have a couple hours, and we'll be out of here by 10. Assuming that some people are a little less than three, and nobody is more.
From him and from another landowner that covers hundreds and hundreds of acres. And those properties both have land, have sites that have bought the Broad Brook Coast conservation area. So sometimes when I am hunting, I might be near trails from and also people tend to use the trails on private properties freely. So even when I'm hunting private property, there's still a chance of bumping into a hiker or a birder. My experience has been, I have never had an unsafe situation or an unpleasant interaction with another person who's hiking or walking. We also, a point that wasn't made was that in Massachusetts we hunt with shotguns and muzzleloaders and archery equipment, which are considered short-range weapons as opposed to high-powered rifles. And that has to do with how populated our area is. But I just think that it's important for people to know that that these are short-range weapons and there is not so much to be afraid of. I avoid getting near a trail or hunting near a trail. I don't expect to see a deer or a turkey near a trail. Other people never know that I'm in, unless I'm crossing a trail or on a trail, people don't know that I'm there. I don't believe that there are many people at all who hunt the same area as I do, but I'm on the perimeters of the Broad Brook.
30 seconds.
30
seconds.
Okay. Anyway, I think that there's room for everybody. Seems to be good room. Hunters are conscientious about safety, number one. And don't shoot in the direction of trails. Don't shoot towards houses. I think that there's room for everybody.
Thank you. Next after Mac Eppert is Erica Glaske.
Hi, I'm a resident of Northampton, and actually I'm here tonight to read a statement on behalf of Jane Potter. Jane's also a Northampton resident, and she's president of the Meadows City Conservation Coalition Board and can't be here for medical reasons tonight. Her statement here is not a representation of the board, but it's personal. And I'll start. I'm not against the practice of hunting, but wish to focus my remarks on whether hunting should be allowed in Northampton conservation land. The first item I'd like to address is access. Should a hunter want to bond with a child in the act of hunting, ample opportunity exists. Any private landowner can allow hunting on private land without issue. This is common practice. In addition, there are 36 state parks and reservations in central and western regions of the state that allow hunting, including Holyoke Range State Park and large forested tracts in Wendell Urban Mohawk Trail and Savoy Mountain State Forests. In addition, the Department of Fish and Wildlife maintains more than 72 parcels in the same area where hunting and fishing are permitted. Nearby towns with DFW management areas include Belchertown, Williamsburg, Goshen, Waverly, Chesterfield, Cummington, Southampton, Holyoke, Conway, Montague, and Sunderland. That adds up to more than 100 spots within an hour and a half radius of Northampton. The second issue I'd like to address regards safety and liability. According to the International Hunter Education Association, approximately 1,000 people in the U.S. and Canada are accidentally shot by hunters every year. Most victims are hunters, but non-hunters are also sometimes killed or injured. Conservation lands in Northampton have no attendants, and there is no provision for enforcement or regulation given budget considerations. How would someone walking in a conservation land know that a hunter is there? Should land be made available to hunting that has no trail or other viable access for an emergency vehicle? In that case, a tragic accident could occur, and there's a question of whether the city might be liable for those consequences. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Next, after Erica Gillespie, is Joanne DeSantis.
My name is Erica Gillespie, daughter of William Gillespie. I've lived in Northampton since I was born. I'm a young woman standing here tonight asking for a chance. A chance to be me and enjoy my hobbies close to home. Yes, I am a hunter. Northampton has taught me to stand up for what I believe in for my entire life. This time, I'm not giving in or giving up. I'm behind my dad 100%. Hunting land in Northampton will happen one day, and I hope you're ready to stand up with me, my dad, and other hunters in the area. Hunting isn't just something I do, it's a part of who I am. I love to be out in the woods, spending time with family and friends. Being out there also gives me a chance to get back to the way things used to be. I love being able to say I can provide for myself. Another benefit of my hunting is I know where my meat is coming from, and that it was killed humanely. I've seen slaughterhouses and the way these companies get their meat. It's sickening and abusive. One quick shot is all I need to get meat for my family for up to a year. That animal's meat is not only feeding us, but it is helping save money for other things my family may need and couldn't afford otherwise. Over the years, I've learned that hunting is all about balance. Biologists work with hunters to keep a safe balance of populations. We now need to find a balance between hunters and other outdoorsmen and women. It's not going to be easy, but the fact that everyone is here tonight means they care about something. Be it animals, hiking, camping, hunting, or peace. Whatever it may be that has brought us all here together to join in a fight for change. We may not all see eye to eye, but given a chance, hunters in this area will show you that we can make this work and that we can all be happy. Equality for everyone, even hunters. That's what I want to see in the town I've called my home for my entire life. Thank you.
Thank you. After Joanne Bissett, Andrew Church.
Although we have gun owners and hunters in our family, I oppose allowing hunting Mineral Hills Conservation. The landscape in Mineral Hills has changed over the years. More people have built homes near or abutting this conservation land, and our homes were. Because of the dense woods and hilly terrain, we cannot see 500 feet into the woods, and a hunter would not be able to see our home or see the family playing in the yard. Also, there's now a network of trails for hikers throughout this conservation. Hunters voluntarily accept the risk, but the risk should not be imposed on families and hikers in this area. And the risk is not zero. Even one accident is too many. And an accident can cause serious injury. A shot can travel more than 500 feet. And not just hunters are involved in these accidents. Plenty of accidents in the United States involve innocent bystanders. They've included residents near their homes and people and dogs walking on trails. In 2012, a woman was shot by a hunter in Norton, Mass. While walking along a path in the woods with her dogs. The dogs were mistaken for deer. The woman's had multiple surgeries and is disabled now. Also in 2012, a shotgun round hit a Berkeley Mass house, breaking the window of a room where a woman was sleeping. There are many other instances, sadly, of innocent bystanders at the farm. I don't believe you can ensure the safety of your camping residents.
Dr. Andrew Church is Kurt Pinkel.
Hi, Andrew Church. Some 40 plus years I've been hunting. I get to spend about 2 weeks out of the year to go out hunting, and I enjoy being in the woods. One of the things that's happened is we adopted the CPA tax, which is our tax dollars and yours, hunters and conservationists, to buy open space land. And I don't think it's right that we take that money that we're being taxed using our tax dollars and say this party can use the land and this party can't. I think it should be open. The other thing is all this conservation land of 2,000 plus acres that we've had over the last number of years that have been taken off the tax rolls that are not open to hunting. It's not marked. It's not posted. There's no fences. And I brought this map of the Sawmill Hills Conservation Area. I own 100 acres, a little over 100 acres of farms, which abuts the Sawmill Hills Conservation Area. If you look at this map, it includes my 100 acres, my house, the neighbor's houses, and there's no lines on here for property lines for what the city owns that's conservation. And I have people coming through my yard every day. They cut trails across my property. I have people bicycling. And one of my best friends who owns another 250 acres that abuts me, that goes all the way to Sylvester Road, there's probably 15 trails that go across his property. Hikers, bicyclers. So people go out into the sawmill, I'm talking about sawmills, but it doesn't matter where we are. They go out into the woods out there, they have no clue whether they're on private property, conservation land, or the moon. Beyond that, you know, I just think that we all pay tax dollars to take land and put it into conservation.
30 seconds.
I think we all should be able to. Thank you.
Dr. Kurt Pinkel, Gary Throat. Kurt Pinkel, one of the people who went to the proposals around all the firearm hunting here. Even the houses.
I'd like to address a few items. First, it's been asked, why can't hunters just drive to a nearby management area to hunt? I would propose to those people that during deer season hunt healthy, they travel to a local sanctuary where hunting is not allowed. New close by are Arcadia and East Hampton, 700 acres, Graves Farm in Williamsburg, 640 acres, DAR in Goshen, 1,770 acres, and part of Mount Town, which is 2,160 acres. These properties far outweigh those which hunters have access to. In response to some comments that was not the wish of previous property owners to allow hunting on conservation land, in the case of the Beaverbrook property, it's inaccurate. The previous owner of the Beaverbrook parcel not only allowed me to hunt his property, but graciously accepted venison and opportunity to show my appreciation. Next, certain stewardship groups power to manage some of the city's land find conservation as preservation. They find it acceptable to remove vegetation, blaze and in some cases pave trails, construct bridges and walkways, all for self-serving reasons and with no consideration for the wildlife to disrupt or displace. I hope this doesn't happen to you, but parcel. That said, these areas are gems. I agree. Even that way, and don't change the thing. Preservation, not conservation, is the goal. And these areas would be better managed by groups such as Audubon or Arcadia, which are familiar with true preservation. At the very least, adopting their policy should be in order. These include no pets, no wheeled vehicles, including bicycles, no jogging, smoking, alcohol, radio, fires, nighttime use, leaving designated trails, and no removal of any plant or animal without approval. Personally, I would like to see hunters and non-hunters work together little ideas and experience, possibly combining resources from the CPA and their matching state grants, funds from land tax applied to hunting, fishing, and trapping licenses, grants from the Pitcher Robinson Act, which is an 11% tax on firearms, ammunition, and archery equipment, and is earmarked for land acquisition and wildlife restoration. Imagine what an impact we could have if we put personal beliefs aside and focus on what really matters. Protection of open space for wildlife and recreation for generations to come. Thank you. Dr. Gary Thune, Cliff Jorgensen.
I'll be quick. I think all, conservation land pretty much something purchased by taxpayers should be open for all legal activities, whether it be hunting, bicycling, or whatever, legal. As far as safety is concerned for hunting, I believe the statistics say it's one of the safest outdoor activities that there is. More people get killed on bicycles, I believe, than that get injured hunting. That's all I have to say.
Thank you.
My name is Cliff Jorgensen. I'm an avid hunter.
Next is Gary.
I hunt in the Middle Spring area, and I hunt on some of the farms surrounding the area, and there's a lot of bear damage. I'm here to talk about bear. And the father of bear being their heart, their sanctuary is in that conservation land. We're not asking for the hunt, crazy. And it's all about being safe, and we care about the land. The farmers are tired of the damage to their crops and their corn. And it's unbelievable the damage they do. You should see it. I mean, crop circles, they're gigantic, And we're just, we'd like to get in there to straighten up the problem and help the farmers out, too. It's their livelihood. And I think there's a common ground. I think we can work together and be able to come to some kind of agreement here to, take care of the bear problem, especially. The deer obviously are a big problem here, but the deer are. I mean, the bear are. So that's all I have to say about it.
Thank you. After Gary, Jim Mazowski. I think I'm pronouncing that right. I can't read it quite well. Barry Elski.
Hello. I'd like to make a point. First of all, I'm for opening up conversation and for hunting. And my reason is, and I'm going to use myself as an example, I'm handicapped. I can't walk very far. I can walk good, but I can only go short ways, and I'm all done. Some of this land that you have, conversation land, is very easy for me to park, walk just a short ways, and I'm hunting. Something I enjoy, I've enjoyed all my life. There's tracts of land that are open to the hunting right near where I live. I just can't get to it. I have to park and walk long ways, and I'm exhausted by the time I get to the area that I can hunt. So therefore, my feeling is that this land should be open to hunting. I think we can all get together as safety. I don't think safety is an issue. That's all I can say.
Thank you. Dr. Jim Mazanowski, Bill Gillespie.
I am Jim Baranowski. I'd like to say that I'm an avid hunter, and I would like to see the land open for anything that is legal, which is within safety.
Bill, Kathy Gillespie.
My name is Bill Velasquez. I was one of the people that submitted one of the proposals. My whole proposal was based off the city's open space plan. There's a plan in place approved by all facets of the city that they wanted to get into place. This is why I'm here, because the open space states several times in that plan the need for increased active recreation, hunting, bicycling, horses, mountain biking, snowmobiles. I feel both groups are very underserved in our city. Our open space plan states the need for environmental equity. Right now, I feel that there's far from environmental equity happening on the lands purchased by the city. It is not equally provided to all people in our population. Distinguishing treatment of an individual based on actual or perceived membership in a certain group or category which restricts membership of one group from opportunities or privileges that are available to other groups, leading to the exclusion of the individual. That's the definition of discrimination. It's hard for me to believe, living in Northampton, that I feel discriminated against, and I truly do, based on that definition, and it fits the definition that we're discriminated against. Many people are going to talk about safety tonight. If you base your safety concerns on sciences and facts and not fears and opinions, I think you'll find that hunting is a very safe sport. Many people here have suggested that we move on to different areas. I live in the town, I pay taxes in the town. A lot of these lands were purchased with some of my tax fees. I feel I have just as much right to walk out my door and recreate as you do to do your recreation. Once again, it was stated there's many other places that other people can go to do their type of recreation, so I don't think that statement in general is fair at all. Hopefully, if we do choose to open up hunting, we keep it open to all types and all implements. It would be unfair to not permit unicycles on our bike trails. It would be unfair not to permit golden retrievers in our dog parks. It would be unfair to not allow hikers with backpacks to walk on our lands. In closing, I'd like to state that you act on the open space plan. I feel that the lands purchased and managed by our city cannot be run as private parks and playgrounds for the chosen few. They must be enjoyed by everyone without prejudice or discrimination. Thank you very much.
Dr. Kathy Gillespie, Bob Dunn.
Good evening. My name is Kathleen Gillespie. I am here to support my husband, Bill Gillespie, in this hunting proposal. Bill and I have three children. Our son is not a hunter, nor am I. My daughters, however, are hunters like their father. It seems to me that a lot of people here tonight have unfounded fears about hunters. Hunters have to go to hunter safety courses. They have to have a background check in order to obtain an FID card to carry a firearm. They are not criminals. Hunters have the same rights as non-hunters. This should include themes of conservation. There also seems to be a misconception between conservation and preservation. If people want this to be preservation land, then I suggest we put a fence around it and don't let anybody in. Non-hunters have the use of this land 365 days a year. Hunters are not asking for the land use for the whole year, just for a short period of time during hunting season. Once again, I am not a hunter. I'm here for equal rights. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. After Bob Dunn, Catherine Giverdeen.
Hi, my name is Bob Dunn. I, too, am a hunter. I've hunted all my life. I grew up in Northampton, and I worked in Northampton. I'm retired from the Northampton Police Department, where I served as a detective for most of my career. And I also served as the shift commander for my last 10 years. I'm here to not represent the police department, I'm long since retired, but only to inform you that during my entire career, I never once responded to a discharge of a firearm that harmed anyone, that it is very safe, and there's no reason that hunting can't occur in the areas of Northampton and where we can coexist with hikers. Hunting is closed on Sundays, and you certainly won't see a hunter on a Sunday, even during the hunting season. The season is so small, and yet there are areas we can hunt in Northampton, and we've done it for many, many years without incident or harming anyone or shooting anyone or anything of the like. And I can tell you that firsthand because it would have come across my desk for nearly 30 years. Thank you.
Thank you. Dr. Catherine David Gangler.
First, I just want to say thank you very much for going through this process. I am very encouraged to see that the committee is asking for information, they're asking for facts. They want to look at everything, not just emotions. I'm very encouraged by that. I am an avid trail runner. I run on wood trails with my wife. out during deer season in particular, that I take certain precautions. I put on orange. I put an orange vest on my dog. I know that I am safer, probably, on those trails with hunters than I am with mountain bikers or with other dogs. My dog has been attacked several times by other dogs on these runs. We have not been attacked by a hunter. I treasure my times in the woods. I find it extremely restorative. But just because someone else's activities are different than mine, because they experience nature in a different way than I do, I don't think that they should not be allowed to use the same area that I am. So again, I appreciate you taking the information and taking it all into consideration. Thank you.
Thank you. And after David, John Clapp.
Hi, I'm David Engler. A long time ago, about 20 years before ago, I was here in the Conservation Commission, but I've worked for a long time too. Certainly, and in my opinion, we were not, as a group, thinking about hunting on properties that were acquired. Standing here as a person who's been on the Conservation Commission in the past, I have to say that I'm not in general in favor of hunting. I'm learning a lot tonight, and I really appreciate the description you gave of the process. It's fascinating. When I was on the commission, we didn't have this issue to deal with or to think about, except for the general tone was as we acquired land, which was the most fun thing we did on the Conservation Commission. It was under the general premise that hunting was never allowed, never would be allowed. And we did take in the abuser property because the owner in that one situation had conditions that it allowed hunting. So that's how specific it's been in the past. I think, from my perspective, I think that wildlife management is a key issue, especially with bear. That has something to do with the trapping laws that we changed some years ago. And that, in my view, I would ask the Conservation Commission on probably an annual basis to meet with appropriate officials to find out if wildlife needs to be managed on a particular parcel. And maybe some parcels will never be managed, but that on some parcels, in specific name circumstances, and perhaps some kind of call would be allowed. I know we have bear problems, but I know from calls I've made years ago, I don't know if it's happening right now, I live by the Y, and there was a bear denning in, pardon the expression, Rosemary's Ingle, which is a conservation area right near my house. So how are you going to control that bear? Right? And that bear might be knocking down somebody's. The other thing, personally, I'm a photographer. I'll be in the woods, not even moving, or in a position for maybe 5, 10, 15, 20 minutes, and I'm in outer space. Recently, I was doing that in the woods in West Hampton, and I finally heard somebody, and it surprised me, because I'm way out there, and it was a photographer. So it just kind of reminded me that there are people being quiet in the woods.
Thank you. After John, Dee Boyle-Clapp.
Yeah, my name is John Clapp. I've lived in Northampton my whole life. My family's on the northern part of Mineral Hills since 1826. And I've hunted in the past. I'm not a hunter now. I am concerned about when we put we have 120 acres. When we put the property in, it was called Wildlife Corridor Program, away from Turkey Hill to Chesterfield Road. And that was my understanding, and I would have put it in regardless, but that was something that I understood. It's a bear, it's there for the animals, a wildlife corridor, not for a hunting shooting gallery or whatever. And I'm sorry I said that. But my other concern is that we have a bed and breakfast, and people hike our trails all the time. And I understand, I think 99% of the hunters are conservationists, and I think that they're very safe, but there's always a chance. And we have our dogs out there, we have our animals in the meadow, and it's not just the safety part. People that don't want to have hunters there are concerned about even the report of a rifle, or a shotgun in this case. And people show up at our bed and breakfast, and they hear a shot, and I have to go through, oh, I understand how far away they are, probably a mile or so away, but they don't understand that. And I think that, and I'm not speaking to the other areas, because I'm not familiar with it, I can't speak to it. But in terms of the area that has been set aside as a wildlife corridor, Turkey Hill to Chesterfield Road, I do not want to see that open to, my land is in conservation and it's restricted to hunters, but it borders the unmineral hills. And I know that 99% would do this, but I have people go in and put up a tree nest or a tree stand on our property without ever asking and without ever any consideration. And it's something that I'm opposed to. Thank you.
Thank you. And after Lisa Zipholz.
Hi, I'm Dee Boyle-Clapp. My husband's family took such good care of the property that they own, it was a 700 to 1,000 acre farm, that when we put that map up earlier, much of the open space in the western part of Northampton was actually their property initially. To the credit of John and his sisters and now his cousin, they put much of that property in conservation restriction. John spoke pretty eloquently about our needs and our desires. Personally, I would not have done this if I had known that we were going to have land and help people hunt on our property. We said no to every single person's house in the last 15 years, but we know for a fact people go in there all the time. They tear down our no trespassing signs, they tear down our no hunting signs, they don't respect the boundaries. It's really frustrating and infuriating. I'm sure all of you who are here who are hunters, you're the respectful ones, you're the folks that care. But the folks who don't care, who don't mind the rules, who don't mind the laws, those are the people that worry me because they don't get far. The other piece I wanted to just say is that someone in one of the letters to the editor wanted to know what intent people had for putting their land in conservation. John's sister passed away a few years ago. She's not here to speak for herself. She did leave that property, though, to my son, and I'm going to speak on their behalf. Mimi would not have ever wanted hunters on her property. She also said no to every single person who wanted to go out there and hunt. And the reason is we can't understand why people do it. It's not something we understand and we don't enjoy. But the intent was no. Do not hunt on this property. Do not put this in conservation restrictions to allow people to go and kill the animals that we put this aside for. We could have retired if we had sold our property and put houses on it. We knew how many people could sell. But we didn't do that. We're not our tools. The other thing I want to say is that our son is going to inherit this property when we go old enough. His intention is to actually do permaculture and wood forest gardens, etc. That's a really cool use of conservation property for our town. Let's use this to the betterment of everybody. I also don't want to say that I don't believe that people are being discriminated against. Everybody's welcome to walk on lands that are open to everybody. I'm sorry that you can't touch more spaces, but I do believe that they're open to everybody who wants to actually enjoy it and appreciate it for a variety of different purposes. Thank you so much for being diligent and being careful and thoughtful. But I'm going to ask you please to not allow people to hunt, especially in the middle hills and about the sun area. Thank you.
After Lisa, Greg Smith.
Thanks for having me. I'm Lisa Asapolitz. I'm from 23 Golden Drive in Florence. I'm here to speak against hunting in our conservation areas in Northampton. The property my husband, David, and I own abuts the Stoneville Homes Conservation Area. We have lived in this location for 25 plus years, and my husband is a native of Northampton. David and I were active in the early stages of creating and maintaining the trails there. And since then, I've done a great deal of hiking in those woods after the conservation area was created. Namely, snowshoeing in the winter, but some of the warmer months. I call it the Wild Kingdom in my backyard because I've seen some pretty amazing things there during my pre-dawn hikes. I have seen my share of deer herds. I've observed coyotes observing deer herds. I've seen plenty of evidence of the pretty graphic that our coyote population is managing the deer very well. I've nearly bumped into foraging black bears a few times. They're more scared than I am. They go running and threaten to run up the tree. One time I accidentally flushed a bobcat from her hiding place and was able to watch I, on one occasion, saw a mother moose and her calf. And I've also been able to do a great amount of bird watching there, including stumbling upon a colorful flock of wood ducks in one of the vernal pools. I think it's a privilege to have such a variety of wildlife within our city. How proud we should be that we are committed to protecting this treasure. What an opportunity our conservation areas offer families to go out into nature and see wildlife in their natural habitat. And I don't think that it's necessary to kill the wildlife there in order to enjoy it. Northampton's conservation areas are thriving. The community preservation and dollars we spend on them are actually preserving precious wildlife, which is important. The species that inhabit conserved lands like the Sawmill Hills are varied, but occur in relatively small numbers and are under mortal pressure as it is because of human factors, such as building that cuts off habitat spaces from one another. It's really troubling to me that we should be considering, as a community, the possibility of allowing hunters in these modest areas to kill very wildlife they were created to conserve in the first place, which is the spirit in which I believed that they were created. While they do contain an abundance of wildlife, our conservation areas are not wildernesses. In fact, when I'm hiking, it is never too far before I can see a house from your ridge or hear domestic sounds coming from someone's backyard. I also want to make the point that hunting season takes up prime time for hiking. So in October, November, and December, when the air is better, when the conditions are perfect for hiking, that's when hunting is allowed. So it's really an imposition on the recreation of hikers. I want you to consider carefully the residents who use this area to listen and to look, and please don't allow them. Thank you very much.
Thank you. After Greg, Jim Reese.
Hi, my name is Greg Smith. I'm an outdoorsman. I am not a deer hunter. What I am is a cop in Williamsburg. And I bet I shoot more deer every year as a result of roadkill than is suffering that I have to put them out. And the particular stretch is that Haydenville, Beaverbrook area, which I believe is one of the areas that are in question. Those deer, now these EPOs, environmental police officers, will tell you that if the deer gets hit, you can take it. The reality is most of the time the meat is destroyed. So this is an animal that it's not palatable, it's been hit by a car, I have to go and dispatch it if it's not already dead. And typically what we do in Williamsburg is just throw it off into the side of the road. That's what happens to it. Now, we're not even talking about the fatalities that occur to humans as a result of it. We're not talking about the damage to vehicles that we all pay for through insurance. There's lots of reasons that deer need to be managed. I'm going to go back to, I'm originally from back east, from Watertown, famous town right now. I did all my fishing when I was a kid at Walden Pond. If you've ever read the book by Thoreau, he will tell you, that man, if he wanted to see a deer back in his day, he had to go to New Hampshire or Western Mass. So through proper management and buying property, which most of the hunters have done, the deer have proliferated. Now to the point, and again, if these EPO guys are still here, all you ought to Google Plum Island. It's an area in North Shore of Massachusetts. Well, everyone loved their deer, and it was becoming a huge problem. But nobody wanted to open it up to hunting. Lyme disease. Everybody's landscape was destroyed. Ultimately, what they did is they hired sharpshooters to come in and take out the herd. If you don't like hunting, and I'm not sure what this whole thing is about, a lot of it I think is very emotional. I don't deer hunt. I don't. But I'll tell you, there's a place for it and it's proper management. I think it's insulting for somebody to stand here and say, my right to walk or to run is more important than a hunter's. That's nonsense. And, you know, the statistics are really for the hunter. If you do your homework, you're going to find out. And again, I'm telling you, I do not deer hunt. No way.
30 seconds.
Okay. But I think you people really need to put it in perspective and accept the fact that hunting is viable. It's great management. This woman was talking a few minutes ago about bobcats and this thing. Why do you think all that's here? It's because of proper management. That's it. I give you 10 seconds back.
After Jim, Paul, both of you.
My name is Jim Reese. I'm from Northampton.
regard, my questions and concerns are as follows. Number one, given that these conservation areas represent a minuscule percentage of the available hunting areas in Western Mass, why add them to these already set aside? There are now over 50 state forest wildlife management areas and wildlife conservation easement areas in Western Mass alone, as well as many private properties that allow hunting. It seems to me there are many, many other places in Western Mass for hunters to go to. Number two, won't hunting in Northampton's conservation area dramatically increase the number of people using these areas to hike, ski, go birding, etc.? Almost all of these areas now are used extensively by many people, including families, and have numerous existing or planned trail networks. Even if it's true that the risk of being shot is very low, the sound of guns from the sight of hunters in these areas will frighten people, and I think many, if not most people, won't take the chance to go in these areas. And for those who do venture out, the normal tranquility and peacefulness of the forest will be overshadowed in the back of the mind by the possibility of gunshots or the sight of a deer or wounded animal. Also, if hunting is allowed using the current Massachusetts open season schedule, people will be able to hunt almost every week of the year, which will further discourage people from hiking in these areas. Number three, I'm confused about why the city would purchase and designate these areas as conservation areas and not potentially not protected animals that birds live there. I thought the city and some conservation groups had strategically purchased conservation areas surrounding the city to serve as wildlife corridors to combat the threat of habitat fragmentation for these animals and birds. Won't allowing hunting on even some of these conservation areas disrupt their need for the diversity of habitats? Isn't there still a need to have protected areas for these creatures to breed and flourish? Is there any evidence that there's really an overpopulation of some animals in these areas based on the information that we have been able to do? So, if hunting is to be permitted, can sufficient public safety enforcement actions realistically implemented? Because it is not clear what specific conservations would be open for hunting, when would hunting be allowed, what actions would be taken for public safety, I recommend to the commission that if it does decide to propose to open up any area, that there be another opportunity for people to express their concerns about a specific plan before the decision is made. Thank you very much.
Thank you. After Paul, Don Wigner. I apologize if I'm not reading people's names correctly. It's all handwritten.
Paul Foster Moore from Turkey Hill Road. I'm an abutter to the Mineral Hills and a member of the Friends of the Mineral Hill Conservation Area. And I really appreciate your willingness to hear out the community this clearly. And what I want to point out tonight is that I'm totally opposed to hunting on the Mineral Hills area. It's an area that is been set aside for the enjoyment of residents 12 months of the year. And it's an area that has at least 30 houses within or at close proximity to that area. I don't understand how hunters know exactly where these 500-foot barriers are and these boundaries. And the area is now thankfully laced with hard-won trails designed with families and children in mind for hiking. Separate parcels were stitched together over time to create contiguous areas designated to preserve wildlife corridors. And we believe that the city planning department also wants to limit hunting to certain existing parcels, excluding the Mineral Hills area. Our neighborhood associations work extremely hard to protect that area. We have raised, out of our own pockets, $200,000 to help set aside that land and make it available not for us, but for the whole city, and at this point, the region. We got trails mapped out, we cleared and blazed them, we marshaled neighbors, Girl Scouts, woodworkers at the Hampshire County House of Correction, and Friends of the Mineral Hills to build a whole network of trails and trailhead kiosks and 440 linear feet of boardwalks over mighty trail sections to prevent unnatural widening of the trails. Does the vast majority of citizens wish to be displaced by hunters during the hunting season? I think not. Does wearing an orange cap and vest really bring peace of mind to all the folks wanting to hike peacefully in this little patch of paradise? I seriously doubt it. While hiking off trail, and I'm an outdoorsman myself, I've come across very stealthy hunters in times past, and I have to say I most likely ruined their hunting experience simply because I inadvertently crossed their potential line of fire. Not a good feeling for them or me, I'm sure. And it will be an especially unpleasant experience for them if a number of us feel like we have to resort to the use of emergency whistles to announce our presence, particularly in grizzly bear country. They're not going to want to hunt there when they realize how popular these whistles have become to the general public. Families won't want to bring their children to this wonderful place. I believe that most hunters are responsible and mature. Their safety record is excellent. However, we also know it only takes a few careless individuals. Accidents do happen. One did happen 8 years ago off of Route 66 where someone was shot in the hand. We'd love the hunters to join us. Just leave your weapons at home.
Thank you. There's a name I cannot read. I think it might be Eileen. Starts with a P, the last name.
I'm Don Reitner. I lived on Sylvester Road for 42 years and have some acres surrounded by conservation area. There's really nothing I can add to the things that have been said tonight. I've experienced all the good and all the bad that you've heard. I've run into all the groups of people that mentioned who are out there using the land. I was particularly pleased tonight, and for some of the things that I've seen in the paper, that there have been lots of facts that have come out, both in the paper, by the young man who was talking up here, and by people who have already spoken. So all I really want to say is that I hope that in a situation like this, both the board and everyone in this room can take into account all the facts that have been put forth and use them to form their own opinions and to make their decisions.
Thank you.
Diane,
very well.
I live down the road from on Sylvester Road. We don't have almost 9 acres, mostly not, mostly back. And we've lived there for over 20 years. There are hunters always on Sylvester Road, and they're probably behind us. And I have no problem with it. Never had a problem with it. However, any given day, there are hunters on Sylvester Road or in the woods. Trucks are there, and sometimes they're walking down the road with like shotguns. And that's why it is. However, there's ample space in the back, and all those acres in the back for them to hunt. Our property goes to the back. We can't see the end of our property. It goes back about a half quarter mile. When I go back to repost my posted sign, they're never there. I have to put new sign up. There is no way for hunters to know where their okay property, where they can hunt, where they can hunt, and my property. You know, and you can't know it. So it is not unusual that we hear gunshots. It is not unusual that we hear gunshots almost all the time, especially during deer hunting season. I don't go into those woods during. I have a little orange cat, but I use it. As a matter of fact, we have an area fenced in for our dogs, and every year we make sure that the orange fencing that goes over our fence to make sure the hunters can see that at least that's possible. I'm happy to put up with it. But given that, I don't know why they have to be hunting. There's plenty of space on Sylvester Road. I cannot speak to other areas, but there's plenty of places where hunters happily are hunting. And so I really don't see the point. And I don't see the point in adding more hunters to that particular area. I think we've got enough people hunting in that area. Not opposed to it, not opposed to them. Thank you.
After Gary, Adam Westbrook.
Many points have been raised in favor of and in opposition to hunting. However, one key thing seems to have been omitted. and that is the fact that the belief that every living thing is only on, put on this earth to serve us. Gentlemen and ladies, that is not the case. Science now reveals that animals are far more like us than we ever suspected. From the molecular analysis of DNA to the very structure of their brains, and close observations of their behavior, we now know that many species experience the same fears, anger, longing, loneliness that we do. Yet too many people in our community seem unaware of this, or if they are aware of it, they dismiss it. I was hiking in Fitzgerald Park last week when I came across two hunters who were searching for a young black bear. When I asked them why, they said they wanted to hunt it, kill it, and eat it. That the supermarket didn't offer bear to eat, and it was a delicacy. That attitude is all prevalent all over the world. That's why we have sanctuaries, to break that way of thinking. If I mentioned hope to you, you'd think about the sentiment of hope. But hope was a baby chimpanzee, which was rescued from its mother, who was being turned on a spit over a fireplace when some observers of the hunters saw it. They noticed a little motion, and they realized it was a baby clinging to its mother. So they pulled it off, rescued it, and even though it was singed, they named it Hope, and they saved its life. Life in this world, in the animal world, is a struggle, but it has rules. Animals have, by design, limits on their power, and there is a balance, so that there is always hope and joy. Yes, when animals frolic, they're just like us. It's joy. We at this meeting are not going to change the world, but we have an opportunity to stop this way of thinking. It has to stop somewhere. That's what conservation areas are about. What are you doing on there if you don't come to this committee, if you don't recognize that? Everywhere across the earth, every living thing is being exterminated.
30 seconds.
The treatment of animals in our ranches and in our farms is horrific. We take pigs and we shoot them out. They never see daylight until they're killed. It is unspeakable, the horror, and if anybody out there, even if the hardest hunters were aware of this and weren't moved, then there is no hope. But that's where it starts. It starts here in our conservation areas. That's what they're about.
Thank you. Dr. Adam, Mark Connelly.
Adam Lesko, live on Sylvester Road, right between North Hills Conservation Area and Sawmill Hills. I'm going to keep my remarks kind of short. I don't have any prepared, much prepared. I come from a family with a tradition of hunting, for both sides of the family, going back generations. I understand that wildlife management is important. I'm also a part of a group that's helped establish the trails, specifically in the Mineral Hills area. I have concerns about safety in and around those trails. I don't feel that hiking and hunting generally mix. I think that there can be, I know that you're still deciding on how this might be broke up if it's allowed. And I think it's important to consider things like setbacks in and around trails as another possibility, specifically in the Mineral Hills area. That's basically it. What I took from that presentation is that it is now being effectively managed, the deer population, when you spoke to that specifically, with the area that we have for hunting, and I think that that's important, that we're doing it effectively now and to introduce another small area. People have spent a lot of time and energy to establish a network of trails with bees around the country.
Thank you. Dr. Mark, Ellen Cookie.
I have a handout. Wouldn't mind saving one next month. I'm handing out, my name is Mark Carmine, and I'm handing out copies of the trail maps for the Mineral Hills Conservation Area. I grew up hunting from a long history of hunting from my family. I hunted right up until 1983, when my brother-in-law was killed in a hunting accident, shot in the head, leaving my sister a widow at 26 years old and my niece and nephew without a father when they were three, twins. I live on Turkey Hill Road, and I'm the coordinator of the Friends of Mineral Hills Conservation Area, and been working with the city since 2006 to expand the conservation area to include the over 600 contiguous acres that we have, 600 acres that we have, mostly contiguous, that we have today. In 2006, we began the expansion of Mineral Hills Conservation Area with the Conservation Commission before the CPA was in place, by working hard to purchase the 150 acres around the old quarry pit. We had 3 months to raise $150,000 with private donations, neighbors, to raise this money, neighbors and people from out the city and from out the region. So we did that. We were able to do it. We did it in 3 months, and we preserved 150 acres around the old quarry pit. That appeal was done on the promise and the premise that this land would be placed in conservation and become a safe place for people to commune with nature and provide protected area for wildlife habitat and for breeding grounds. Hundreds of people donated to that effort on your behalf, on behalf of the Conservation Commission. All this work is done on behalf of the Conservation Commission. We did it again in 2008. When we preserved about 75 acres, what was known as a coal parcel, that connected the old La Palme parcel, the original La Palme parcel, with the quarry parcel. The connector was the coal parcel, which we got, which we raised about $75,000 with private donations to preserve that land. Then in 2009, we did it again with 40 acres for the Skibisky parcel, and we raised about $35,000, and most recently, the Bookend Project. So all of this, again, is done on the promise and the premise that this is safe land for people to hike, snowshoe, cross-country ski, bird watch, dog walk, scouting troops, geology clubs, and more. And since 2010, the Friends have developed the network of trails that we have that I gave you out. So in summary, guns and safe enjoyment of the land don't mix. I don't know why we would change policy. There's extra copies up here if people want copies.
After Ellen, Joan Rob Frank, Franken.
My name is Ellen Franken, and I live on Sylvester Road. I want to urge you to maintain current policy of personnel for the conservation. I echo all of the things that have been made, that we just land for preservation for enjoyment. The noise of guns is jarring, and you cannot enjoy a tranquil, peaceful walk in the woods and listen to gunshots. We have, I believe, hundreds of acres behind our house, which are used for hunting, and we hear multiple gunshots on a daily basis. And it's not only during the short years, it's often throughout several months. And it's disruptive to us to hear these gunshots, and it also, I acknowledge that there's a lot of things that's available for hunting currently, and I particularly urge no hunting in the Northampton, but I echo everything that Mike said. And I believe the conservation land that many of us have contributed to should be kept the way that it is. I wish you much for your hunting.
Thank you. After Joan, Kathleen Ellington.
I am against hunting, but hunting has been going on since it's been banned. It's strange to me that we now have to manage wildlife, because managing wildlife is a man-made notion. Part of the reason we have to manage wildlife is because there's so much development. So now we have a bear problem. Some people think we have a deer problem. I have not seen a bear problem here. There's in the entire state of Massachusetts, there's no more than 3,500 bears, and I think that's an overestimation. So I'm sure there's not, I don't know how many there are in Northampton, but to say that we have a bear problem, because bear come into where people live, well, where are they supposed to go? They don't know their boundaries. We need, as humans, to live side by side with our animals. We can't survive without them. I'm also interested in knowing, when we talk about hunting, what kind of hunting we're talking about. Are we talking about responsible hunting? The CONSCOM will have to decide what strategy they will use to create a smart plan if they do decide to hunt. What types of animals? How many animals? Why? Why is there a bear problem? Because a bear eats crops because it's hungry? Also, the issue of recreating, especially the Sawmill Hills property and Fitzgerald Lake property that I know, those two properties are heavily recreated, and I do worry the safety of hikers. I worry for the safety of the animals in conservation properties, especially in Sawmill Hills. There's a lot of fragile ecosystems. There's vernal pools there. Do hunters know where bat vernal pools are? Do they know what habitat is fragile? I'm not so sure. I'd also like to say, before my time is out, that I'd like to ask the CONSCOM to think about if they do allow hunting, that they may end up being liable since it is city property. If there are any accidents, they'll be liable to show the public where hunting is allowed, so they're not. So the public is not in the safety risk. So think about whether how much liability you all may have besides that. That's all.
Thank you. After Bob Zimmerman.
My name is Ethelene Ellington. I live on North Pond Road, not very far from the Sterile Lake area. And I would like the Conservation Commission to think really seriously about the profound benefits
The main justification for the city's acquiring conservation land is for two purposes, really. It's for the ability or the opportunity for people to get out into the wild habitat and enjoy natural surroundings undisturbed. The second is to allow wildlife and plant life to prosper in their environment in an undisturbed fashion. Were the Conservation Commission to change the existing regulations on the use of conservation areas, it would be a major change in the rules that have been established over the past several decades. The 2,500 acres of conservation area are really a drop in the bucket compared to land within Northampton and certainly land outside of Northampton.
those areas are precious areas that should be preserved. For the people that use them, but particularly for the wildlife that use them as well. Hunters, or those promoting hunting, will argue that the city's open space plan has advocated for the opening of more hunting land in the city. But nowhere does the open space plan say that that hunting land should be conservation. Those supporting hunting in Northampton also argue that their CPA tax money goes to the purchase of this conservation land. That's true, but it's only true in part. As we've heard tonight, enormous amounts of private money have been donated to the creation of conservation lands, and in addition to that, there are federal grants, state grants, donations of land, donations of conservation restrictions, a tremendous number of different methods have been used in the acquisition of conservation land. And many of those who have donated money would be very shocked and disturbed to hear that that land was going to be used. Furthermore, paying a tax does not buy you specific privileges. Taxes, as we all know, are collected for a community of activities, whatever that community is. And we all know that our taxes go for purposes which we either don't or can't use. So I just don't buy the argument that CPA taxes buy people the right to go hunting in conservation areas. Finally, I want to mention that I am not anti-hunting. I respect hunting as a legitimate enterprise. I am deeply opposed to hunting in Northampton conservation areas. And I believe, just in one statement, that we have got to keep our focus on hunting and conservation. It's not hunting in general. It's hunting in conservation areas.
Thank you. Dr. Sarah Starr-Booker?
I also would like to ask you to please not allow hunting on conservation lands in Northampton. I am one of the people who opened up my checkbook to help purchase the Mineral Hills area, and when I did so, I was very glad to do so with the thought that I was helping to preserve a wildlife corridor and natural wild spaces. And I would have been happy to do it even if I never had the opportunity through those areas myself, just know that they are there. Because I don't regard conservation land, a lot of people make use of the term recreation, and they talk about hiking and hunting as recreations, even as equivalent recreations, which they're not. So I don't really regard the purpose of conservation land primarily as being one of recreation. I do a lot of work on climate change issues, and I read very widely at this point about climate change, and it's very disturbing and frightening to really look into what we've done to the planet and the consequences for our children and for our own viability. And all of that has arisen out of our attitude for the Earth as a place that we can exploit, that exists for our support and for our pleasure and use. But in fact, the Earth and we need to be in a relationship of give and take, of symbiosis. Otherwise, balances are destroyed, and it's a great risk to our well-being. But when we have the opportunity to preserve a small amount of wild space, in my mind, it's holy, and I use that term with some surprise because I'm an agnostic and a Unitarian, but I think it's holy. I think these are sacred spaces. I think we need them. I think we all need them. We can walk through them lightly as observers with respect and reverence and awe and not looking to making use of the place, but being humble
Esther.
My name's Star Drucker. I live in Florence. I own a vegan restaurant, Evolution. I was raised Quaker. I'm not a Quaker. I'm opposed to murdering any living thing for sake of sport. I personally find that revolting. And I talk to a lot of people in the community of vegans. And there's actually a fairly large community in Northampton and in the region. We're the only vegan restaurant in Western Massachusetts. So Northampton is a very unique place with people who actually care a lot about broader issues. And that's why probably this is a deal here. It's not just about parcels of land. It's about how this community feels about itself and how it wants to identify itself. For myself, I became a vegan because my son was in school and they were saying, oh, here's a cow. What's a cow for? A cow is for milking. Oh, what's a tree for? Trees for building. And I realized, a cow's not for milking. You can milk a cow. A tree, you can build a building, but it's just for itself. These are just things in and of themselves. We're talking about living creatures, whether we're going to kill living creatures on this particular patch of land. That's what we're talking about right here. Hunting as a sport, I don't think is a wonderful thing. I think it's a horrible thing. Hunting because you need to live, I think is a wonderful thing. Sounds weird for a vegan to say, but I think it's absolutely fine. If people are going onto this land because they are starving, and the last thing they could possibly find is animals that are living on this tiny little parcel right here, then I'm behind it. But it seems that doesn't seem that way. It seems like we're talking about recreation, murder, recreation, killing animals that we don't need to. If we need to, I mean, that's where I think you guys have to figure out where the facts are. I mean, we don't know whether if the population is huge, we gotta lower it. If it's down, we gotta bring it up. But just saying it's a matter of, well, I got the right to hunt or not the right to hunt, or even I'm a vegan and I think you shouldn't do it, but that has nothing to do with it. It's really talking about living creatures, and do we want to kill these living creatures just because we have things that can do that? Or is this a different community that we're in? And one that actually has a tremendous amount of compassion for living things. I wouldn't want to be in your shoes right now. But thank you.
After Esther, Austin still here? No. Edward Zukowski?
Sometimes these terms are used interchangeably, when in fact they're two quite different things. If we're talking about preservation, then that means leaving the land totally natural. No trails, no footbridges, no changes by humans to any of the land at all. However, if we're using the term conservation, we're allowing certain uses of the areas involved, and certainly improvements to make access easier to accommodate people. As I see it, to allow activities such as hiking, jogging, bird watching, and the like, and yet deny access to those of us who like to hunt and fish, is clearly discriminatory. I also realize that hunters make up a minority of the population. I believe the number is around 17%, but Northampton and our surrounding towns have always prided themselves in being welcoming, tolerant, and accepting of all minority groups. I ask the question, then why not hunters? Our safety track record is outstanding. We help control the animal populations, and as a result, the spread of Lyme disease, as well as animal and vehicle collisions, such as the one which killed Ed Need last week in Southampton Road in Westfield. We're not looking for special treatment, just equal treatment. I urge the Conservation Commission to seriously consider allowing hunting in our conservation areas in Northampton. Thank you.
Thank you. I gather you're speaking as an individual rather than as a city council. Next up is Karina Miller.
I want to thank the Conservation Commission for having this forum this evening. I think this is fair that we're hearing he wants to do hunting and he does not. Support hunters 100%. My family has hunted. Also, I have friends who are hunters, and they also hunt for food, and I don't have a problem with that. But I do have a problem when you're looking at mineral hills. I have to say, in 2006, as a city councilor, like Mark Carmian, Joanne Perfett, Paul Foster Moore, the Ward 6 Association, we worked very, very hard to preserve the acreage at the Ward. I have to say that Mineral Hills is absolutely beautiful. The site contains dramatic views, it's pristine, diverse plants and animal communities, and one of the most important wildlife corridors in the city. The site also contains a quarry with unique geological features and two vernal pools. And we've heard a question tonight about vernal pools. We purchased this property so people could use it for walking their dogs, hiking, bird watching, snowshoeing, and to allow families to become familiar with a variety of wildlife in the area, such as deer, moose, turkeys, and coyotes. I am very, very concerned about the conservation land in our city of Northampton. And I don't have anything bad to say about hunters. But when we acquired the Mineral Hills, we were told that we were preserving the wildlife in that area, and that's where my concern is. And as a city councilor in the year of 2006, I feel that we were misled when we were told we were preserving it. And I can't tell you how hard we worked to get that $200,000 so that we could go ahead and apply for grants. So I want to thank you.
Thank you. After Karina Miller, Mary Jo Stanley.
I've come tonight just to sort of try to present someone that kind of bridge to world a little bit. I anticipated that it might be as divided as it feels, and I don't know that everyone else has put so much tension in the room. And I was raised in Northampton, I'm 5 years old, but I've always been out there and happy with it.
Can you speak up just a little bit?
Yeah. But I've always been outside of Northampton. I was born in England, and I come from a family in England that always hunted, and that most of life in England, at least my family, spent around hunting, or weekends spent shooting. And the seasons have been taken extremely seriously. So, my grandpa was hunting tiger in India. Almost that delivers for me to be here, saying what I'm about to say, which is, at this point, I have no interest in hunting, but when I'm in England, I'm still involved. tension between the two groups. I know it doesn't feel like that much in this room right now, but it exists. It's true. And when I see hunters shooting, it's not necessarily what I'm up to right now. I'm not necessarily judging them. I could very well marry someone that hunts, and that would be enough to sort of figure out. So I guess I hope that we can continue whatever to have a little bit more of merging between the two groups. And I can see the division, and I get it from both sides. I really sincerely do. I just, ultimately, everybody likes being outdoors, and they'd like to do it in their own different ways. But, you know, I'm not for hurting the animals. I wince when I hear the shotgun, but at the same time, I'm not for people feeling marginalized and feeling misunderstood. I think that there's an extra step that we could all go just here, which is trying to see a little bit more of where everyone comes from, which is that they're all trying to preserve their history.
Thank you. And then Vanessa O'Quinn.
Take an animal with respect to whom we are at their table, more than kill me, I go to a supermarket and buy some chicken that somebody else killed. I myself wouldn't take the life, but I'm eating something that somebody, life that somebody took. And not necessarily in my way. Hunting is already allowed in a section of Fitzgerald Lake. I have been there when I go there in hunting season. I wear orange. I was laughed at once because people were saying, "What are you doing?" I said, "Well, they are out hunting over there. I don't think it's used to." So I'm used to it. I wear the orange when I walk my dog. I go wear orange also. I only encounter hunters twice. Very respectful. They put their guns down. Let me go. My dog went. No problem. I think that you have a tall order here to reach a ceremonial decision. I hope you reach a ceremonial decision, but might not please anybody, but we'll meet the need or at least some of the needs of everybody. And that's all I have to say. Thank you.
Thank you. Dr. John, is in the puddle?
Hi. Hi. I live in Northampton, and I walk in the woods. Walk my dog. And I just want to report experientially that by the end of hunting season, one of my dogs is a complete wreck. I have to pull along on the walk. By the time, you know, May or June, and she's forgotten the gunshots, she scampers. I have trouble keeping her with me. But after 2 or 3 weeks of hunting, she's done. And I'm not a complete wreck, but I'm nervous. It's not fair to say that walking in an area and shooting guns in an area are the same. They're not. When you walk in an area, you don't scare your neighbor. When you shoot a gun in an area, you scare people. I don't want to discriminate. Certainly not at all. But all occupations aren't the same. They're different. They can be equal, but different. Some pastimes impinge on other pastimes. If I took a boombox and walked to the conservation area with it turned up full, I suppose that would be illegal, but it certainly would ruin the area for a lot of people. And I have to say that hunting really does ruin walking during the hunting season for my dogs, for me, and for lots of people. If I were to make a practical proposal, although I don't like hunting, I would say let people hunt on Mondays, Wednesdays, and Fridays, and if there be no hunting on Tuesdays, Thursdays, Saturdays, and Sundays, then on the 3 days when hunting is allowed, I can keep my dogs out of the day hunt, keep me out. The rest of the time, we can walk around knowing that we're not going to be frightened or in danger. I think that should be a statement. Thanks very much.
Thank you. And after Linda, our last speaker is Deborah Bagichal.
I really have no opinion. I came here because I wanted to learn, and I learned a lot. Basically, what I learned is we're trying to manage it. Deer herd when we're having a lot of trouble managing the human herd, but I guess we'll learn. I'm just going to tell my experiences. I walk in the meadows. I was walking in the meadows during pheasant season, and it was filled with dogs with the bells, and our dogs went crazy one time and went running into the pheasant hunting area, and pandemonium broke loose. Dogs, bells, hunters, everybody running after these dogs. And so one of the hunters came out and said, "You know, I really don't think it's water." So I said, "I found the dog. He helped me. We got the dog, and I left." And no, we couldn't. We just couldn't cohabit. And so that's one experience. And the second experience was where we lived. There was a huge pack of coyotes. And they roamed all over, and they killed all the cats. And some neighbors decided that some mysterious way the coyotes disappeared, and that was 2 years ago, and now we have deer. We never had deer before. The third experience is we moved down here from Buckland We live way, way out in the hills in Buckland, and we had a lot of road front. And we posted, but, you know, that didn't make any difference. People hunted anyway. But we knew practically everybody that was hunting, so that was okay, too. But then, during the hunting season, the shotgun season, that's when the city people came in, and or wherever they came from. Doesn't have to be city people. The woods were just overrun with people swamping through the woods who were not local. I mean, or who weren't people who respected the people who lived locally, and that's it. Thank you.
Good, thank you. Deborah.
I had a very interesting discussion recently with a man who hunts. He explained to me about the benefits of hunting for the animals. Animals go hungry. They die of starvation. Due to overpopulation, there's not enough food to feed all the wildlife who live there. So they're supposed to starve to death. And as he talked, it occurred to me there is no species that is more overpopulated on this planet than our species, Homo sapiens. And I asked him to think about the number of people on our planet. Some of our cities, Springfield, Worcester, for example, are overpopulated. People go hungry. People live out in the cold sometimes. Sometimes they go hungry, sometimes they starve. Perhaps the solution would be to establish a quota for them, an agreed upon number of people to be killed, therefore lowering the population enough so that there would be enough jobs, enough food, enough homes for everyone. The hunters agreed to trap and kill humans as a favor to our kind. Perhaps, I imagine, you can recognize the absurdity of this suggestion. In this country, people are put to death for intentionally killing other human beings. In this country, people kill animals, view it as a recreation or hobby. It is a sport. When we kill animals, it is called sport. Why is one thing different from another? What I feel is that there is no difference when a deer is shot, a bear, or a coyote, or a bobcat. These are my family members who are killed. Family is not only those who are blood related. Family are the ones you are concerned about. They are the ones that you are in a relationship with. My family members reach beyond the honorable man and woman who gave birth to me. My family members are all of the creatures who live around me. When they are killed, I feel the loss within my own being. Committee members, as you ponder this important issue, I ask you to consider what it would be like to be that animal at the other end of the gun. Do any of you remember the movie Planet of the Apes? What if you were out there? What if it was your partner? What if it was your child?
30 seconds.
What if the bullet took the life of someone you loved? These animals are beings that I love and my family. Please choose to save them, not to sentence them to a likely death. As you make this decision, please consider that the needs of all the species we share our planet. It is not ours alone. It belongs to all of life. And I would close with this quote from Henry Beckwith. They are not brethren. They are not underlings. They are other nations caught with ourselves in the net of life and time, fellow prisoners who plunder and prevail on the earth.
Thank you, everyone. Yes?
I couldn't get here until later.
The Gazette
said it was a meeting from
7
until
10. Well, we do in fact have time if you want to state your name and take the podium.
Thank you so much. State Park in a tiny town called Wells, New York. I know a lot about Humpty. My mother's father was shot to death when he was 40 by a hunter. My mother was only 20. He was a wonderful man. His grandchildren never knew him. Every year, we heard horrible hunting stories. My mother was shot at in her own yard, over road, by a hunter who was walking with his son wearing black. The kid's excuse when my mother confronted him, I didn't know the gun was loaded. I saw so many hunters pulling guns out of cars, along with cases of beer. I know people were shot at their roofs wearing red union suits while they were repairing their roofs by hunters. I know a guy who was doing it running a deer check station, who came out because the hunter said he couldn't carry his deer, came out and looked at the car and said, bag me a big one. It was a cow! And the saddest story, another sad story I knew, was there was a family. A father went hunting with his son and his best friend. The father killed his own son. When he discovered what he had done, he told his best friend, you go get help, I'll stay here. When his best friend came back with help, they found the father dead next to his son. That man's wife was left with no husband and no son. These people didn't make these mistakes because they wanted to. They probably were trying to do the best thing. They were probably reasonable hunters. But you're playing with firearms. Firearms are deadly. Mistakes happen. The woods are dark and deep. People see things they don't always know what they're shooting at. When I moved here, I was so delighted at the thought of being able to walk in our conservation areas in the fall, because I knew I wouldn't be shot at like I would be if I was home, or risk being shot at if I was home. Please don't take that away from us. There's plenty of places where you can go hunt. My dad, my family was so poor, he once went out and shot a deer because we desperately needed it for food. He cried the whole time he dressed it. He said, I don't care if we starve. I'm never doing this again. Please don't let this happen in our conservation area. Hunting isn't necessary. Other creatures, the last speakers have said, these animals have rights too. These conservation areas are places to conserve wildlife. We know now that animals have feelings. They have, they're much more like us than we ever dreamed. I don't want anyone to shoot my guide dog if they wouldn't see them. Thank you so much.
Pardon me? A last one, and then we have to close.
My name is Keith Davis. I live on Stonebridge Drive in Florence. Just a few quick comments. I regularly hike the conservation areas in Northampton. I think the vast majority of the people who have worked really hard to create those areas with money did so with the expectation that there would be no hunting. I'm not against hunting, and I'm not happy that it's become an argument of hunting against hunting. I think it's an honorable sport. I don't think it has a place in the conservation areas. Personal experience, I was woken up once in the morning, and I was in bed, and there was a hunter. I saw the yellow vest. He must have been about 30 feet from my bedroom window. The vast majority of hunters would do that, but there was a small majority who were not respecting the 5-foot barrier. I expect that will happen in a very small majority of cases if you allow hunting in the conservation areas. It's not safe. Hikers in the conservation areas don't expect to encounter hunters. I think at a minimum you'd want to have a 500-foot buffer around hiking trails to allow people to hike in the conservation areas. I don't want to restrict hunters' rights, but I believe there's vast areas in the state that they can hunt in, and we need to have local areas where we can confidently hike without hunters. We have that. I don't see any reason to change that, and I wouldn't want to be in your position to make this decision. In fact, I recommend you don't make the decision. I think it should be a citywide referendum and let the city vote. Why should you be making this decision? You've seen very good arguments, you've heard very good arguments on both sides. How could you make a decision? Put it to a vote, put it to a referendum, and get it on the ballot with the citizens of that city. Thank you.
I want to thank everybody. ongoing rich discussion. We do not have a specific schedule for when we're going to pick this question up again in our Conservation Commission meeting. We meet the second and fourth Thursday of every month. Tomorrow's meeting is already full, so it won't be then. But it'll be posted when we do address it next time.
Thank you.
Thank you.